Today we are talking positional groups. Who has the advantages and who doesn't? We're going to discuss that and more here on the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast.
Your Locked On Panthers, your daily podcast on the Florida Panthers. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
And welcome into this Thursday, June 6th edition of the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, where it's your team every day. Thank you for making the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast your first listen of the day. I'm Armando Velez from the Hockey News, and you can follow me on X at MondoMan12, follow the show account on X and Instagram at LO_FLAPanthers, and shout out to the everydayers who come back here and get your daily Florida Panthers fix. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code LOCKEDONNHL for $20 off your first purchase. Terms and conditions apply. So, Florida Panther fans, we are 2 days away from Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final. But before I start this show, also congratulations to the Florida Everblades for winning Game 3 against the Kansas City Mavericks in comeback fashion in Game 3 of the Kelly Cup Final. Now lead the series 2-1 and are 2 wins away from making history and three-peating in the ECHL. But on today's show, we do have a guest today where we are going to discuss more about the positional groups between the Florida Panthers and the Edmonton Oilers as we are just getting ready for Game 1 of the Stanley Cup Final, and it's almost here. He is formerly of the Rat Trick. He is Daniel Janicas. Daniel, welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Thank you as well for deciding to come on to the show. So I want to discuss more. I want to start off with the forward group for this Stanley Cup Final between the Florida Panthers and the Edmonton Oilers. Obviously, the biggest storylines is going to be Connor McDavid versus Alexander Barkov. I mean, just the tale of these two players, of who they are, the best offensive player in the league versus the best defensive player. I mean, it really makes for such a great final too. I mean, for it historically in their matchups, I know it's going to be a lot different when they meet up in the final, but the possession metrics for Barkov favor him. So, and when you think of how the Panthers throughout their playoff run, it's been for them a lot of controlled play. We haven't really seen too many lapses in their play. Meanwhile, on the other side for the Edmonton Oilers, I mean, watching that Western Conference final for them, you never knew which team was going to control play for them coming out of an intermission, because sometimes you'll get three shots on goal from one team in Edmonton, Dallas, and even before in Vancouver in that series. But then you see a big turnaround for them, and it really starts with Connor McDavid. So how are you seeing this forward group for them, especially with that? And also Sam Bennett matching up against Leon Draisaitl. Him historically has had great possession metrics as far as that. So how are you seeing this forward group as far as the top six?
Well, I guess to start with the Panthers, they've been a team that have kind of just rolled lines 1-4 out and have been very successful doing that. In terms of the top six specifically, I think they have all the tools and arsenal necessary in the bag to be able to compete, and not only compete but win against this talented Edmonton Oilers group. Obviously, make no mistake, the Oilers probably have the advantage up front, having, you know, Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl, best player in hockey, and then Draisaitl arguably, top five forward in the league, right? So they're going to have their hands full. But I think Paul Maurice has done a good job not only rolling out four lines, but being able to get the favorable matchups, especially within the top six, that's needed so that, you know, they can score, defend, and do whatever else they need to do based on game, situations and whatnot.
Yeah. And the McDavid, Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, Hyman line is really the only line that has really stuck together the whole run. I mean, Kris Knoblauch has shuffled the lines here and there. I mean, the Draisaitl-McLeod Perry line have only been together for 30 minutes together. Henry, Kane, and Holloway, 21 minutes. Yanmark Brown and Derek Ryan together, too. So that's another thing when it comes to that. And also when it comes to intimidation and sandpaper, you have a player on each side for each team. I mean, you have Corey Perry, who's in his fifth Stanley Cup final on his fifth team. Evander Kane, who has played, who has that playoff experience too with him. He's not going to be intimidated by the moment for them. But also, I think for the bottom six, I think the big players who I'm going to be looking at, with a guy who has top six scoring ability but is shifted down a little bit, that I think that the Panthers really do have this advantage in with the bottom six. I think Vladimir Tarasenko, this is going to make for hopefully a good series for him. And I mean, this is when you think about what the Panthers traded for him, it was really nothing for what they got for him. And they're getting, and it took a while for him to get, I mean, he got going a little bit in after the trade deadline, but a little bit stalled a little bit in his goal production too. But you're seeing him block shots, getting back on the back check too for him. And I think this is great for someone like Anton Lundell on that third line of now that they ended the Eastern Conference final on a little bit of an upward trajectory.
Yeah, I think this series is going to be all about how the non-big name players are going to, you know, show up. Obviously, you got the matchups of Barkov, McDavid, then you got Bennett, you know, on top of Draisaitl, you know, that defensive matchup right there. Of course, then you got to throw in Matthew Tkachuk on our side. But I think what's key for me, though, is related to your point, how will other players step up, fill the void, and be able to contribute when less eyes are going to be on them, especially from the Edmonton Oilers, as a lot of their attention is going to go towards Barkov and Tkachuk, and rightfully so. So this brings in the deal of guys like Lundell and Tarasenko, considering that the attention, especially defensively for the Oilers, is going to be on Barkov and Tkachuk. That allows other players more time and space to maneuver with the puck in the offensive end. And it also gives them more scoring chances too. So I think that's going to be key. I think depth scoring is going to be critical if the Panthers want to win the series and ultimately win the finals. And to your point about Tarasenko, you know, it was a great trade by Bill Zito, another shrewd type of business what's regarded as one of the best GMs in the league. And it was pretty well known that Tarasenko wanted to be here. He wanted to be a Florida Panther. And I think that's what helped Bill Zito and staff to be able to pull off that trade with, you know, minimal pieces, because the Panthers, if you take a look at their cupboard, they really don't have a lot in the cupboard right now in terms of picks as well as prospects. So you take a look at the return for Tarasenko, and considering what he brings, I think it's safe to say the Panthers won that trade. But basically, to wrap up this point, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think this is a series where the Tarasenkos, the Lundells, and I also think the Luostarinens as well, mm-hmm. need to perform. They need to step up, and they need to continue to contribute, or if not even more, if the Panthers want to succeed, because there's going to be times Barkov and Tkachuk are going to be clamped down. That's just how the Stanley Cup Finals are.
Yeah, and Vladimir Tarasenko, resident of Weston, so that's a big part of him coming over to South Florida, and also Etsy Luostarinen and being able to play in the Stanley Cup Final, unlike last year for him. So this is a big opportunity for him. I'm sure that he's really looking forward to it. And for the Panthers, also their fourth line, even though you can mix and match, I mean, the difference between the Florida Panthers and the Edmonton Oilers is you've only really had to use 14 forwards for them, for the Nick Cousins and the Ryan Lombards, who aren't even in. And even if they're in, I mean, I don't know how much cheating for offense you're going to get with that forecheck when the Edmonton Oilers are exiting out of the zone. You see that a lot in the regular season, but even if they're in, interesting to see how that's going to look for them. But I would say for the forward groups, I would say for the depth, I would say advantage Panthers. What would you say?
Yeah, I would have to agree. I would be fair and say I would probably give Edmonton the top six, considering yes. they have McDavid mm-hmm. and Draisaitl. But that, you know, I don't want fans to read into this point too much. Rest assured, I think we also have a very talented and deep top six as well that shouldn't be underlooked. But in terms of, to your point, to the bottom six, yeah, I would give it to the Panthers. And it's interesting because it brings me down memory lane in terms of last year where the Panthers were very top six heavy. And that's kind of where the wheels fell off come time to when they played Vegas in the finals, when there was just too many lost bodies there and bottom six players were kind of having to fill those top six spots and voids when guys like Tkachuk were out or, you know, Montour was kind of skating on one leg or whatnot. So, I think Zito has done a very good job shoring up that void that we had this summer. And now looking at the team currently speaking, I think it's safe to say we for sure are deeper. And there's a lot more options, especially when you don't have to have Nick Cousins or Ryan Lomberg in the lineup every night. And you can kind of switch Kyle Opozo in and out as well. It's a good problem to have.
No doubt. And like I mentioned on yesterday's show, the circumstances for the Panthers are a lot better this time around. We're going to transition over to segment number two, where we're going to discuss blue line and goaltending for both teams. Who has the advantage there? We're going to discuss that and more next on the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. And Game Time makes NBA and Stanley Cup final tickets even faster and easier. Prices on the Game Time app actually go down the closer it gets to tip-off or puck drop. With killer last-minute deals, all-in prices and view from your seat, and their lowest price guarantee, Game Time takes the guesswork out of buying NBA and NHL tickets. The last-minute deals, you could save up to 60% on last-minute for sports, concerts, comedy, theater, and more. You can get zone deals. Save even more when you choose a section and let Game Time choose the seats. You can get a panoramic view from your seat in the app before you buy. And you can download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code LOCKEDONHL for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account and redeem code LOCKEDONHL for $20 off. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. Welcome back to the second segment here on the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast. Thank you once again for making the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast your first listen of the day. Here with Daniel Janicas, formerly of the Rat Trick. And are you watching Fox Sports or ESPN on your TV all day? Had to turn down the volume with all that shouting? Make the switch to Locked On Sports today, a free 24/7 sports streaming channel programmed for you every day to bring you the biggest stories without all the screaming. Locked On Sports today brings you the can't miss analysis, opinions, and news streaming 24/7 on YouTube or the free Amazon Fire TV channels app, part of Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. So, Daniel, continuing this conversation on the positional groups for the Florida Panthers and the Edmonton Oilers, let's go to the blue line for both teams. Great. When you think about the last few years of Stanley Cup champions, you think Vegas, you think for the Colorado Avalanche, for them, I mean, blue line has been the biggest strength of those teams, and they won despite their goaltending, regardless of it, they really protected the house well. Thankfully for the Florida Panthers side of things on the blue line, before we get to Sergei Bobrovsky and Stuart Skinner, they haven't had to switch anything once throughout the postseason. And that's really been a thing since even Paul Maurice has been here. Even last year with the last pair being Mahura and Gudas, and crazy to think that Mahura can't even crack the lineup when we talk about the depth for them. But even for the Edmonton Oilers side of things, they've had to switch things around their blue line. Nurse and CC were a pair for a bit, and then all the backlash that came Darnell Nurse's way, especially in the Western Conference Final, they switched things a lot up there with now him and Kulak and now Broberg and CC. But even the Nurse and Kulak pair, they're a minus goal, two goal differential in 49 minutes together throughout the postseason too. So that's another thing when it comes to how the Panthers forecheck can really get those guys under duress. And we could maybe also talk about what it does mentally when the D is under duress, when the puck gets loose after a forecheck, and how you have to quickly have your head on a swivel and maybe overthink things too. And that's really what the Panthers forecheck really does. It psychologically, it really messes with opponents. So how are you seeing the blue line for the Florida Panthers that have not made any changes whatsoever, and with the Edmonton Oilers on the other side of things. Oh, hold on. Let me unmute you. There we go.
Well, I think looking at both, I think the Panthers have the better blue line. I mean, I think the statistics are pretty evident of that. I was looking at some charts yesterday, and heading into the series, the Panthers rank first in all defensive metrics throughout the playoffs, not just heading into this series, but as well as the previous three series that they just went through. So I think it's pretty clear that the Panthers are the stronger defensive team. I think they play better team defensive hockey, which is a testament to Paul Maurice and his system and how he likes to coach and deploy his players and his system, of course. So I think heading into this series, I think Edmonton has more question marks on their blue line. Obviously, they have some fairly big names like Darnell Nurse, Matthias Ekholm too is a name, we've heard over the years, especially when he was plying his trade in Nashville. But I do see some age kind of coming through the crack with this Edmonton defensive core. And I think that's where the Panthers can really strike gold if they're clinical enough around goal.
Mm. Yeah, and also got to give credit to the top pair for the Edmonton Oilers too, with Evan Bouchard coming out party for him. He's the power play quarterback for them. I mean, when you think about, it's crazy to think how just a few years ago, even with Dave Tippett as the head coach, there was a lot of noise with whether they or not they should trade Evan Bouchard after that. And now Matthias Ekholm has really helped them elevate his game. Ekholm being more of that stay-at-home defenseman, Bouchard, even though he can jump on the rush, you see him more staying on the point too, and that's why they call him Bouch Bombs for a reason, for him too. So that's another thing. But I think when top pair, I think it's really a push for these two when it comes to comparing them for the two teams. I mean, this is going, if the Panthers are going to win the Cup, Aaron Ekblad has got to have his best series yet. He talks about his health, that he is as healthy as can be. Obviously, hockey, the NHL and the hockey players, they're not going to reveal their injuries neither. But still, this is going to be one that Aaron Ekblad has got to have the series of his life, because they are going to be especially with that last change, you're going to see them with the McDavid line. And thankfully, just like how Matthias Ekholm has helped Bouchard's game, Gustav Forsling has really helped Aaron Ekblad elevate his game too. I mean, yeah, there were times where Ekblad got caught in the Boston series too, but honestly, every single time he's been able to recover, and him and Forsling have been really able to really shut down the Rangers' top stars. I mean, you think about Pasternak, Kucherov, Artemi Panarin, Mika Zibanejad. I mean, you like, this is going to be the hardest test yet. I mean, this is the best player in the world we're talking about on the other side when you're thinking about the Panthers' blue line too. So how are you seeing this for the Panthers?
Yeah, I mean, I think to your point about Aaron Ekblad, he's kind of caught some heat throughout the playoffs for some lapses within his defensive game. But like you, I found him to kind of bounce back and kind of respond well in a good manner, both him and Gustav Forsling, whenever a mistake was made. And again, I think that's just a testament to Paul Maurice's system and how he coaches, this group. Furthermore to Ekblad, I completely agree. He definitely has to have the series of his life. This has to be his best series, along with Gustav Forsling and the rest of the group, considering they are going up against the best offensive juggernaut in the league, and that's Connor McDavid. And I can assure you that Paul Maurice is going to have Alexander Barkov shadow him the entire series whenever he's on the ice. That's going to be the matchup. And on the defensive end, Ekblad and Forsling, they're going to have their hands full, and they're both going to have to watch McDavid, but they're going to have to be careful that they don't get caught with the double team, because that's where they're going to get burned. And I think that's an area where Edmonton has been able to take advantage and leverage certain offensive situations to their benefit. And I think we saw a bit of that against Dallas, with McDavid, the way he was kind of able to weave in and out of traffic, right? And you saw that highlight reel goal. I don't even need to explain it. It's probably going to be, you know, the goal of the playoffs, you know, barring any other highlight reel goal that may occur from now until the end. But, you know, you look at that and how easy he was able to just pull that off. The Panthers, they have to have their radar up at all times, especially when 97 is on the ice or even 29. And Ekblad, Forsling, especially Montour, they may have to take a step back offensively in order to ensure that the job gets done defensively, because that's how many problems, and I want to say that's the magnitude of headaches that guys like McDavid and Dreisaitl can give you. So you kind of have to pick your moments and you got to pick your battles. And I think another thing too I want to mention is the Panthers have to stay out of the box. I mean, the Oilers' power play, I think right now, correct me if I'm wrong, is ranked top in the playoffs. I could be wrong, but I thought I saw that. But no doubt it's been hot, and no one can argue that the Oilers have been feasting. They have been living on the power play. And the only way to prevent that is to stay out of the box. Now, obviously, penalties are going to happen. But if the Panthers can find ways to minimize the amount of power plays they give the Oilers and man advantages, that's only going to help them, because that's just eliminating another way that the Oilers can score and put up offense.
Yeah, and the Oilers, and the difference between the Panthers and the Oilers, I would say, is the Panthers force less as far as trying to get things on the rush too. So that's another thing of especially when the puck is at the blue line and whether the Panthers fumble it and the Oilers pick it up in the neutral zone, what will happen then if they're trying to force something when they're going for a check when the D does have the puck there. So that's going to be interesting to see there for the Panthers there, because we know that if they turn the burners on, it could be game over there. And even though we're more than confident that Bob can stop breakaway opportunities too, but you mentioned special teams. Actually, we're gonna actually go into the special teams matchup for the Florida Panthers and the Edmonton Oilers here. We're gonna discuss that and more here on Locked On Florida Panthers podcast. Segment number three here on this Thursday, June 6th edition of the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast. Thank you once again for making the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast your first listen of the day here on a Thursday. Here with Daniel Janicas, formerly of the Rat Trick, to discuss more about special teams, goaltending, and coaching for these two teams. And for special teams for the Panthers, it's crazy. The penalty discrepancy for these two teams are a little different. The Oilers have had two more power plays than they have been on the kill. So 51 power play opportunities, they've been on the kill 49 times. The Panthers, they have had 60 power plays and been on the kill 51 times. So a little bit of a different discrepancy is when you have the puck. And that obviously goes back to when the puck is in the opponent's end too. So that has a lot to do with why penalties are drawn. You can draw hookings with your board battles, tripping, you name it, holds, all that. So that's another thing that I'm looking for, is getting pucks in deep and battling it in the corners to see if you can draw something too. So that's another thing. So, but for the power play, the big one that you need to stop if you are the Panthers, you need to get Zach Hyman away from the front of the net. That's what you need. That's the guy who you need to contain on the man advantage. McDavid is gonna try to weave around the defense and players gonna draw to him. But if Zach Hyman is getting going for the Oilers there on the power play, it could be game over for the Panthers. And how the Panthers counter that with Sam Reinhart too, that's another thing that the Panthers are gonna have to do with that, him getting the bumper position. I'm sure they're gonna, but 46 of 49 for the Oilers on the penalty kill too. Crazy how much that has changed ever since Knoblauch has been part of the mix. And I mean, that goes to the credit of Stuart Skinner. Your best penalty killer is your goaltender too, so that's a credit for him, for Stuart Skinner. Bob has not faced as many shots as Stuart Skinner has, so maybe that's another thing of, yeah, goaltenders need to get into a little bit of a rhythm when it comes to gameplay too. But I think with the going back to something I said yesterday, the fact that the Panthers, even though they played one more game, but they haven't logged as many minutes because of the fact that last year there was a 4 overtime game too, and 7 of them, and 7 overtime in general. That I think that with arrested Bobrovsky, as far as workload and shots that he's getting, and also the fact that the Panthers are in the opponent's end and drawing more penalties too, I think the goaltending though, it's in favor of the Panthers, but the special teams, got to give it to the Oilers there. The proof is in the pudding with how they're able to score on the power play. But Zach Hyman is my guy to watch on the other side. How about you?
Obviously, I'm going to say Connor McDavid. He's the best player in the world. But, of course, he's going to be the most man-marked player in the series, and undoubtedly. So to turn our attention to Zach Hyman, the point you mentioned, obviously the Panthers have to keep an eye on him. I mean, he's leading the playoffs in goals, correct me if I'm wrong. Career year across the board for Zach Hyman in all metrics, especially on the offensive end. And he's very much a Johnny-on-the-spot type player. He loves to clean out the trash. He likes to take out the garbage in front of the net. You know, we hate it, but that's his bread and butter. That's his game. And you best believe that's how he's going to live and die through the series, is in front of the net and cleaning up any rebounds that, you know, Sergei Bobrovsky gives up. So it's going to be crucial, that the D are able to clear any chances that are in front of goal, including rebounds that Bob's going to kick aside, because he's not going to be able to smother every shot. That's just the nature of the game. So Zach Hyman, I would agree, is one. Obviously, Connor McDavid, and then Dreisaitl. And I guess to also throw out another notable, I'll put Ryan Nugent-Hopkins. I mean, he's always good for a goal or two in every series. And, you know, he's a good player and one who's probably not going to receive a lot of attention this series, given the magnitude of their offensive lineup. So Panthers are still going to have to be wary of guys like Ryan Nugent-Hopkins and even Connor Brown, too, who's a guy who can chip in every now and then with a goal here or an assist there.
Yeah, and it's also I've also noticed that on the penalty kill for the Panthers, how of the confidence level that if the puck is a little loose, getting that little poke to get it out into the corner and battle it out and get a little bit of a clear too, that's another thing that the Panthers have been responsible when it comes to the PK too. So that's another thing of how quickly you're able to react to just even something like that so that you could reset. And for the Panthers, they stick really tight and don't leave the middle of the ice open too much for them. So I mean, both teams, they're facing the biggest challenge yet too for them. They both can score on the power play, both can kill. So and also, I mean, but at the same time with this stage of the Stanley Cup final, in Stanley Cup playoffs, excuse me, not as many penalties are called too. So I'm wondering how many man advantages each team is going to have to begin with, especially with how game 6 ended in the Rangers series, how there were only 2 power plays and it was in the first period too. So that's another thing that I'm looking at, which the Panthers, I mean, based on 5-on-5 numbers, their goal differential is +7 going into the final. The Oilers is +1 too. So that's another thing too of how many of those advantages are the Oilers going to get, even though they have the special teams advantage as far as conversion rate?
Yeah, I think you mentioned a good point. Power plays very much could be scarce. They weren't last finals. I do recall there being quite a few power plays, handed out, especially on Vegas's end, but that's neither here nor there. But I could see the refs very much kind of pocketing the whistle, so to speak, as the old expression would go, which I think would play into the Panthers' favor because I think it's pretty obvious that the Oilers' power play has been stronger this entire postseason than the Panthers have, which, to be honest, hasn't been able to get going at all the time, but there have been some times where they have been able to cash in and find a goal or two in certain areas, which a lot of the times have been timely goals that have helped them. So I guess it's going to depend which Panther power play is going to show up. And I think in a way that the power play is a little Jekyll and Hyde. I don't want to say that it's a non-existent power play, but I use the phrase Jekyll and Hyde because you just don't know which side of the coin you're going to get with this Panthers power play. Is it going to be one that's moving the puck quickly, like when we saw with the Reinhardt goal in overtime against the Rangers, where it was boom, boom, boom play in the net? Or is it going to be some typical Panthers power plays where the puck just keeps getting rung around the board and cleared? So I guess time will tell. Game one will be very critical to see how special teams is going to play. But if I was to say which end of special teams would play in Florida's favor more, I would say their penalty kill has been stronger than their power play, if I'm being truthful here.
Four power play goals against in round one, one in round two, one in the Eastern Conference Final. So I would say as the Panthers have advanced, their penalty kill has just become stronger, as the Panthers are killing at just over 88% for the postseason. So I do agree with you that the penalty kill for the Panthers is the better end of special teams for them. So that's a big matchup for the Panthers going up against the just an unstoppable force, it seems, in David and Draisaitl there. But last one, coaching. I don't know how much we're going to spend on this, but Paul Maurice just about 100 wins away from second all-time. Maybe he'll do it in the next like two or three seasons there. Obviously the most losses regular season in NHL history, but hey, how do you get there? By coaching so many years. I mean, Kobe Bryant, most missed shots in NBA history. Why? Because he gets the ball. Brett Favre, the most interceptions. Why? Because he gets the ball a lot. Same thing with Paul Maurice and the losses, because he's coached a lot of games too. And 20 plus years at the helm, making the adjustments necessary. I mean, going to those lines in game five, putting Tkachuk with Barkov, and then seeing how it didn't work after a goal, after Carter Verhaeghe went on that line for a little bit. And then he's like, okay, let me switch this up. But also the Oilers have 16 different goal scorers while the Panthers have 14. So that's a little bit of adjustments of Knoblauch, putting guys in like a Sam Carrick to Adam Henrique, a veteran player. So knowing when to plug the right pieces at the right time. For Knoblauch, Calvin Pickard, putting him in the Vancouver series too when necessary, when Stuart Skinner was struggling too. So plugging in the right holes at the right time for him. So both coaches have had their fair share. But, I mean, I can't not go with Paul Maurice in this case for who has the coaching advantage here. How about you?
It's hard not to go with anyone who's not on the Florida Panthers, you know, us being Panther fans. But if we're being objective, it has to be Paul Maurice. I mean, Knoblauch has, like single-digit games under his belt when it comes to the postseason, whereas, you know, Paul Maurice is already in triple digits, over 100. So he's been here a lot. He's obviously last year was his first finals. So Maurice obviously carries a lot more of the experience. But to give credit where credit's due, Knoblauch, I think, has done a remarkable job with his Oilers group. Of course, there's talent, you know, surrounded around him, you know, from left to right on his bench. So it's not like he's talent starved or anything, but I think if I was to give some credit to Knoblauch in comparison to other coaches previously with the Oilers, I think he's found a way to sort of put the pieces in the right positions on the chessboard, so to speak. And I don't think you've seen that in the past with previous Oilers coaches. And I think that's a testament to why they're here. But back to the coaching matchup. Yeah, I would say Maurice has the clear upper hand heading into this series, considering his experience, but as well as his age. So if I was a neutral fan, quite frankly, I would be choosing Paul Maurice. But at the end of the day, the coaches don't lace the skates. There's only so much they can do. So for me, clear favorites, Paul Maurice of the Florida Panthers. Of course, you know, you can't overlook Knoblauch and what he's done so far in his pretty young coaching career.
Yeah, and although it's been short for him and his tenure, he's plugged all the right pieces there for him. So that credit to him, or credit is due in the short time for him. But Daniel, I want to thank you so much for joining me on this edition of the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast. Thank you so much for discussing all of these different matchups and positional groups for the Florida Panthers, as now we're 2 days away from the Stanley Cup final. Tell everybody where they can follow you online, my friend.
You can follow me on Twitter at Daniel Janicas. I mean, it says it in the graph, the graphic, so you can find me there. And that's probably the best way to reach me or chat about our Cats.
Awesome. Thank you, man, and hope to see you again soon.
For sure. Thanks again.
And if you like what you're hearing, please subscribe to the podcast to be notified every single time the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast jumps into your podcast feed. Don't forget to also subscribe to the other shows on the Locked On NHL Network, including Locked On NHL, Locked On Fantasy Hockey with Flip Livingstone and Stu Roden, and Locked On NHL Prospects. Thank you once again for making the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast your first listen of the day. So I'm Armando Velez with Daniel Janicas, and you've been listening to the Locked On Florida Panthers podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, where it's your team every day.